Hello everybody, I am Sripath, Certified Financial Planner Professional and an advocate. I am with Dr. Anil Sangli, Consultant Neuro and Spine Surgeon. Today we are going to discuss on the topic Neural Synchrony through Music and Dance, a very interesting topic. Music and dance are an integral part of our lives. Indian forms of music and dance have their own unique characteristics, which invariably includes the concept of rasa. Rasas are aesthetics associated with auditory, visual, literary or musical piece of art, and they evoke highly orchestrated emotional states. That means they have a relation to the brain and the mind. And the brain is it can be called as a divine engineering marvel. The role of brain and mind in music and dance, which includes specific gestures, movements, listening, dancing, etc., are all integrated and dynamic, which have a mental and they provide, you can say that they provide visual concentration. And when we talk of the word rasa, rasa is a Sanskrit word which means either juice or essence or taste, depending upon the context in which it's being used. And this is the basic concept in Indian arts and music that indicates the emotion and feelings of not only the performer but also the audience. An artistic creation which does not have any emotive feeling is dry, heartless and doesn't impact the mind. That's for sure. And rasas are mainly, they are created by the state of our mind. In other words, the bhavas. We have a wonderful Sanskrit shloka written in the Natya Shastra by Bharat Muni, which says, Yato hastaha tato drishtihi, yato drishtihi tato manaha, yato manaha tato bhavaha, yato bhavaha tato rasaha. It's a very interesting. So you have the concept of motor sensory coordination, the visual coordination, the bhava, emotions, feelings, rasas, and the brainy aspects of these things. And ancient Indian scriptures, especially the Bharata Muni's Natya Shastra and Abhinava Gupta in his works, have dealt with the rasas. And they give importance to the bhava also. And pure bliss, then experience of consciousness, awakening of spiritual and moral principles, these are the quintessentials of the rasa bhava theory. And every form of Indian art, be it dance, music, theatrics, paintings, sculptures, literatures, what not, they have rasa and bhava in them. Even the epics, Ramayana and Mahabharata, are full of rasa and bhava. Basically, the rasas are produced by the consequence of one's determinant in performance of any art, which brings about the basis aesthetics of rasa. According to our shastras, we have 9 rasas, which probably everyone knows. And these are also alluded to certain specific colors like white, green, red, etc. And there are different types like Shringara Rasa, Hasya Rasa, then Bibhatsa Rasa, Karuna Rasa. So all these are the emotive aspects of the brain. When we have a neurosurgeon here, I think we'll tell Dr. Anil to explain about the brain and how music and dance are related to the brain. And we normally speak of dance and music with respect to normal people, but you have been studying on people who are suffering from neural ailments, how dance and music helps in those patients. So we'll be discussing on that. Doctor, first of all, I want to welcome you, and I want to ask you, what is in the brain?
Brain is a structure. It's a something extremely complex. Mm-hmm. It's a structure which contains millions and millions of neurons. Mm-hmm. So there are about 85 to 100 billion neurons.
Oh-ho.
And the connections between the neurons, you have about 300 trillion.
Mm-hmm.
which is akin to that of the stars in the galaxy.
Mm.
Each and every brain has so many neurons and so many trillion connections. That means it is such an intricate network of connections.
Mm-hmm.
And every neuron is just a cell. Like, if I want to explain very simply, this is a skin. Skin has got a cell, the cell of the skin. The liver, liver cell, lung, cell in the lung, renal, renal cell. Each and every cell has got a cell membrane inside a cytoplasm, and in the middle it will have a nucleus. This is a basic thing. Now, this cell in the neuron, that's a neuronal cell, will have processes. These are called dendrites. The dendrites may be one dendrite, two dendrites, multiple dendrites, one or one single axon, unipolar, bipolar, different types. And the thing in the neurons is there is no single continuity. There is a neuron and another neuron. In the junction between the two neurons, the axon of one neuron and the dendrite of the other neuron come into communication with each other. At this junction, there is what is called as a gap or a synapse. This mm-hmm. is called a synaptic gap.
Mm-hmm.
At this junction, when the nerve impulses or the electrical impulses travels from one neuron to the other neuron, at this junction, there are some chemicals that are released at the synapse. And these are called the neurotransmitters.
Mm-hmm.
And these neurotransmitters, once they release the chemical, there are some receptors on the opposite side which take up these neurotransmitters and then transmit it to the next neuron. The junction between the two neurons is called a synapse. And when the nerve impulses transmit or the electrical impulses transmit from one to the other, at this junction, there's a chemical that is released. This is called a neurochemical substance or a neurotransmitter. And this neurotransmitter has got a receptor on the opposite side, and the neural impulses are transmitted from one end of the neuron to the other end. And this type of transmission is called a synaptic transmission or the electrochemical transmission. So,
mm-hmm.
a neural, and this is extremely fast. It's in 1,000th of a second that the impulses transmit.
Mm-hmm.
That's exactly the reason why once I prick you, immediately you take your hand off or you attack or you withdraw. Something happens immediately within a fraction of a second. That is because the impulses are so fast. This happens everywhere, whether it is in the brain, whether it is with the visual cortex or auditory cortex, whatever it is, it happens.
Doctor, in a normal activity, like we are talking with each other, what happens in the brain?
When you are talking normally, see, I will give an example. I see something, the visual impulses go to my eye. Through the eye, it goes to the visual cortex and then to the cortical regions. I listen to something, it may be very familiar, it may be something unheard of, it may be a song, it may be something very scary or very something which I like. All these things go to the auditory cortex, from the ear through the auditory nerve into the auditory cortex. And then it goes into the various areas in the limbic system, memory areas, the frontal cortex, basal ganglia, cerebellum, etc. These are all the multiple intricate connections. So when something happens like that, this is called a somatosensory impulse.
Mm-hmm.
And then from there it goes to the brain, and then there is a motor impulse. Motor impulse is the one which is actively seen. Sensory impulses are the ones which are transmitted, which go inside, and what comes out is a motor impulse. This is what happens in the normal parlance.
Doctor, this is in the normal activity of a person when he's walking, talking, and doing his daily routine. What happens when a person listens to the music within the brain?
When he listens to music, there is something which is totally different which happens, whether it is music or whether it is dance. If it is music, the person listening to the music will have one sort of an effect. One who is already singing and he also listens, he will also have some sort of an effect. But the one who sings with a proper melody and intonation, that fellow will have an excellent amount of reaction that can be seen to the MRI images or the functional MRI in the brain or the PET CT scans, where you can actually see the activity of the brain through the amount of blood circulation in the brain. Here, when you're listening to music, like how I told you earlier, the same auditory cortex goes to the brain, but the various things in the music, like you have the musical qualities of music, like it may be a pitch, it may be the rhythm of the music,
loudness,
or it may be the loudness,
the timbre.
Yeah, all the characteristics of the music will have separate representations in the brain.
Mm-hmm.
and the way in which you sing, the melody of the particular song, the lyrical content in which the song is being sung, the actual meaning of the song, and whether it carries some the tune which is a very happy tune or a sad tune or a tune where you are praying to God or something like that, these things will have an effect on the brain. And if you are listening to it, it is just passive. If you are actively singing, it is something more because you are vocalizing also. And sometimes what happens, if you are dancing along with this, there is a totally different architecture of the brain which comes in. Because when you are dancing, you have to think, you have to imagine what step you have to do the next step. And then you have to keep moving your arms and fingers in a coordinated fashion. And at the same time, you will have to bring out your expressions with relation to the song. That is what you call as bhava. And these expressions, when you bring out with relation to the lyrical content, the tune, the timbre, the melody, and one particular aspect of that song which needs to give a particular effect on the brain, that is the one which causes the activation of almost all the centers of the brain. See, the frontal lobes, the basal ganglia, the limbic system, the hypothalamus, more importantly, the cerebellum or the small brain, where there is a lot of coordination between one brain and the other brain, and the synchrony which happens from one half of the brain to the other half.
Mm-hmm.
And one more thing, I am talking to you, you are talking to me, or you are singing to me and I am listening. There is a synchrony not only between myself, between the two halves of my brain, but there is also a synchrony between me and you. My brain is also synchronizing with your brain.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
If I am actually listening to you in a proper way,
mm-hmm.
the synchronized aspect of your brain which I am seeing, that's will why be imbibed on my brain.
Yeah, that's why it's marvel.
The yes, brain that is why marvel. Brains yeah. are marvel, and music and movements are much more of a yeah. marvel.
And probably the rasas are the electrical and the chemical.
These are probably the chemicals, like mm-hmm. how you said there are navarasas.
Mm-hmm.
I will tell you the different types of rasas which are being secreted in the brain. Like I am very happy, dopamine is secreted, serotonin is secreted. I am very sad. I want to learn something.
Mm.
Then there is some other chemical called glutamate which is secreted.
Mm.
A mother is fondling her child with lot of love and affection.
Mm.
A lot of oxytocin is secreted, and again dopamine is secreted.
Mm-hmm.
And I am feeling very sleepy. GABA is secreted. I am having lot of pain, and I want to go away from the pain. And if I do some exercise, endorphins are secreted. And if I am extremely stressed out, cortisol is secreted.
Mm-hmm.
In this different rasas or different bhavas, there are some specific names.
Mm-hmm.
Like how you said, these are
Shringara rasa, then Bivats rasa, Karuna rasa.
All those things are probably taken in as the different type of hormones which are produced mm-hmm. in different states of your mind.
Mm-hmm. So probably your brain also dances and sings.
It reacts to the dancing and sings.
Okay. One more thing. Whatever you are telling is related to a normal person, normal individual. What happens in persons who are not normal in the sense neurologically they are ill?
There are multiple scenarios here. Whether it is a problem with one side of the body, one part of the limb itself, or whether it is a psychological problem only with relation to the mind, if it is whether it is depression or anxiety combined with depression, or if a patient has got a hemiparesis, that is one side of the body is paralyzed, it can be because of injury or stroke or tumor or whatever. The end result, what you see outside in a patient is he doesn't have he has problems moving. He is not able to move the right half of the body or left half of the body. He is not able to talk properly. Sometimes he is not able to understand properly. Or even if he is able to understand, he is not able to express it out properly. These are all the different things which happens. And there are multiple things. There are each and every part of the brain can give a deficit. Deficit means the problem which is causing a neurological disturbance where that particular part of the brain is not working. Like for example, if I have the motor cortex in the left side which is not working in the leg area, my right leg will not move. If there is in the right leg,
there is
a cross representation in the brain. And if my right part of the brain in the leg area is not working, my left leg will be paralyzed. Or if my speech cortex is injured, I will be having problems with speech. Whether it is articulation, I'm not able to articulate properly, or whether I'm not able to tell what I need to tell properly at all. My peripheral apparatus in the mouth, the movements of the lips, the movements of the tongue, etc., all those things will be abnormal. So in such situations, I will give an example. In a normal situation, when a person tries to learn something, a lot of hormones are secreted. The neural connections, what I told you earlier, the synaptic connections, which are related to that particular area of the brain. For example, I'm trying to learn a piano or a veena or a violin, whatever. When I start doing that, I'm not comfortable, I don't know how to hold the instrument. I will be moving my hands and my fingers in a very abnormal way, and the sound that is produced will be very harsh. And later on, over a period of 1 month, it will be little audible, okay. And then over a period of several years, you will gain expertise. Why is that? That's because you keep on doing the same thing again and again, the neural network will build up.
Mm-hmm.
For example, if I go to gym, if I'm very thin, I keep on going to gym every day, doing exercises, my muscles will definitely build up. That is because of the repeated activity, repeated exercises, repeated amount of blood circulation which goes there, the amount of nutrition which ends into the muscles, and the buildup of the muscles with proteins, etc. Same way, it happens in the brain. This happens by a synaptic transmission, which I already told you. And this synaptic transmission gets on becoming stronger and stronger.
Mm-hmm.
And it becomes faster.
Mm-hmm.
For example, at the 10th year, when you are able to play the veena or the violin, you will be much better off if you practice it at the 20th year, and much better off at the 25th year. So that depends on how much you practice, how you practice, your involvement, your mentation, and your commitment. All those things matter. So when you do that, the amount of neural network, the synaptic buildup, is very high.
Mm-hmm.
In the same way, if you don't practice, either you use it or lose it. If you don't use it, then the synaptic, you lose it because the synapses become very weak,
okay,
and the neural network will deteriorate,
uh-huh,
and then you will not be able to do it. The same way, in a patient who's got a problem, if he's got a movement problem, then you'll have to try to inculcate the problem with the hand movements. He's not able to talk properly, he may be not able to pronounce a particular word or a specific sequence of sentences. In those situations, they will be able to sing. That is because there is a different pathway in the brain that is involved with
speech
singing and involved with just ordinary speech. So if you utilize that singing area of the brain to bring out those words in a fashion where there is a melody and rhythm, he will be able to utter those words.
Mm-hmm.
But if you tell him to say it normally, I will say, "Baba, black sheep, have you any wool?" He will not be able to say this. I will sing the same thing. Baba, black sheep, have you any wool? This is a tune I'm giving him. And he will utilize the tune and he'll be able to sing it off fast.
That's the power of music.
Power of music. Okay. And when they start uttering those words with the communication through the singing, they will be later on able to tell it normally,
articulate in a better manner.
Mm. That is how it happens in the brain when a person is abnormal.
Mm-hmm.
If you are utilizing dance along with music,
mm,
like I am telling you to dance, move, do your movements,
mm,
and then sing, then you are actually activating several areas of the brain and the body. It is a somatosensory input, the motor area of the brain is involved, the cognitive aspects are involved, the planning aspects in the brain are involved, and the coordination aspects of the brain are involved, and the way in which you have to do the skill and the articulation, and the, like how you said, the bhava, that is the secretion of those
emotive aspects,
neurohormones which cause that particular emotion. All those things will be conglomerated and then it is released. It's at a particular point
of time. Complex process, actually.
This is a complex process, and it will cause an increase in the neuroplastic response.
Okay.
The synapses, where there is a neurosynchronization, the synapses which are very weak will start getting better, it will become stronger, and multiple synapses start building up.
Okay.
This is not only a neuroplastic response, it is a neuroplastic synaptic response also.
Okay.
That is how the patients with brain injuries having problems, or it may be injury, or in the sense it may be a problem with relation to the brain due to several whatever it is, and that is how they start becoming better. That's how they recover.
So music certainly helps in the patients with neurological ailments.
Okay. Now I would like to ask you, Sripad, like I want you to mimic some abnormal person having a pathology, like I would say a right-sided hemiparesis, which is very common. That's why I'm taking this scenario. A patient with right-sided weakness, secondary to stroke, he's not able to move his hands, he's not able to move his legs. Over a period of time, he will slowly regain his power to a certain extent. He will have spasticity, movement difficulty, tightness in the arms and legs. And he will have difficulty in speaking, maybe stuttering, or maybe having difficulty in articulation. How this particular person behaves when you are giving music, when you make him sing, and when he gets a little better off after repeated exercises.
Certainly.
In the form of our music therapy sessions, which we give regularly.
Surely, Dr. Agar.
Now, you will see Sripad demonstrating this in several case scenarios. Sripad will now demonstrate a patient who has got a right-sided hemiparesis with spasticity. That means the movements of the right side will be restricted. The right hand, the right shoulder, and other areas of the right half of the body will be hampered. There will be a lot of spasm and rigidity in the right side. So just taking a cup of water to the mouth, or just having a spoonful of morsel into your mouth, will have a lot of problem for the patient. And this is how normally, without music, how a patient tries to get a spoonful of morsel, or just take it into his mouth. He has such a lot of problems. Now Sripad is demonstrating, this is how the patient will have problems. There will be a lot of tremors. He is trying to get that cup into his mouth. It sometimes goes there, and then he is trying to support the right hand with his left hand, and there is a lot of tremor because of the spasticity. He is not holding the cup properly. And most of the times there will be a spillage, and he is trying to drink it, and when he gets it in the mouth, it may either overshoot, or he may be able to drink it properly, or sometimes it will be partly inside and partly outside, and he will spill it off. And when you give it with music and train the person, when you are trying to do this with music, this is how it happens. In a musical session, we have trained the patient to just move the hands in such a way that it should be in accordance with the rhythm of the music. Now he is trying to move it on the table right and left so that it will not spill out. And he is taking support of the left hand with the right hand. Now he is trying to lift it. And when he is trying to lift it, he is doing it very, very slowly. And with every rhythm of the song, he is trying to do it very slowly. He is now trying to get it into the mouth. He is just bending forwards. This is exactly how the patients do when they try have problems. Now when they try to do it and bring it very close to the mouth, it either spills or it either overshoots. And they have a lot of problems lifting the right upper limb, because there may be a periarthritis of the shoulder, or there may be because of spasticity. Now with every musical intonation, he is trying to lift it up and down, so that with that type of a rhythm, he should get used to move the particular tumbler with his hand, and his mind also gets relaxed, so that over a period of time, he will be slowly able to lift it and then take it to his mouth. With every movement of this song, rope chilling, he is just getting it towards his mouth. Getting it towards his mouth. He is trying to use the rhythm of the song to get it his mouth. And this is how they try to do it. And we try to train them in such a way so that they will be able to use the particular rhythm of the song and then get their normalcy. Now Sripad will demonstrate a patient who has got a right hemiparesis, who has got a lot of problem trying to walk. He has got a spasticity on the right side. Now he is trying to have a circumduction gait.
then using his stick and trying to come forwards. Now he has plasticity in the right upper end of him. When he uses a music, this is how it looks. Now Sripad will demonstrate how a person with music utilizing the rhythm walks. It's the same patient having a right hemiparesis, spasticity, difficulty in walking. Now it is utilizing that particular song by using the rhythm. With every rhythm he puts in a step. This is how we train them to walk in such a way that they'll be able to use the rhythm of the song and then move. We are giving a